I've heard things to say about the puffy Jesus of churches in the past, and unfortunately, most people still prefer the puffy Jesus, because puffy Jesus isn't going to tell them what to do, and he's not just about to be demanding from them anything whatsoever. But our Lord said quite plainly, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. These are his instructions. You see, how can you be a disciple of someone or claim to be a disciple of someone if you don't do what they say? And I've said before and pointed out to you that in things like the rebellion of Korah, Numbers chapter 20, when fire came out from the presence of the Lord and cremated Korah and 250 prebendaries of the congregation dead, and then sent plague in the camp, Aaron had to run down, you remember, with his censer and wave incense before God between the dead and the living. This plague was stayed, 14,700 dead, if memory serves. Were these the wicked, like the Egyptians? No. Were these Africans to the south, or Hivites, Perizzites, Jebusites, Canaanites to the north, Moab, Midian to the northeast? And no, these were his own people. These things only happen. I've noticed this shifting amongst professing Christians. Don't let it happen into you and to seep into you. The shifting away of things that impinge on people's lives is one of the techniques of the broad roader to help keep God at a distance, keep him out of their mind, keep him out of their life, and keep him in that shed down the road in order that they can live their life how they want, free from him, and then protect their sinful backside and make sure they don't go into hell as they see it when they die, when actually it's only actual Christians who can go to hell. They don't like to hear those kinds of things. And when you point out that actually it, when you read the from Numbers 20, as I've just spoken about, that it was fire came out from the presence of the Lord. Who? Which Lord are you talking about? Well, it was the Lord Jesus Christ, wasn't it? And when you see later on Nadab and Abihu, Leviticus, the end of chapter 9, beginning of chapter 10, Nadab and Abihu, sanctified priests, crossed the line and did that which they were not given to do, offered strange fire, burnt to death. Fire came out from the presence of the Lord and burnt them to death. And there's umpteen New Testament examples and all the rest of it. The Lord Jesus has not changed. And the one thing you'll notice about Broad Road nominal Christians, they will not listen to the notion that actually the Lord Jesus is totally intolerant of everything that is contrary to his way and nature. He's not a licentious, debauched, parish pervert of the Pope religion at all. He's not like your trendy, charismatic jeans and t-shirt prancing pillock on a stage that you and I are familiar with. That whole religion, Christianity and church, is an ongoing rank denial and of his procedures and his ways of doing things. You cross the line in the new covenant, you die. I've seen people heavily chastened of God. I could name you a number of people who are seriously ill, teetering on death all the time. They're that bad. Chastening of God? Oh yeah, no question. Who's the puffy Jesus you see there? Now, by contrast, for you and I, if ever these people are going to see that there is a difference, guess where they get to see it first? In you and me. don't they? You see, it is us. When Scripture speaks about us being the salt and light, Jesus said, "You're salt and light," to his disciples back then. He says the same things today. We are the savour of death unto death to them. We make them feel the fact that they are spiritually dead and cut off from God and in the wrong place. Which doesn't exactly make us popular, but who's looking for popularity? We want to be found faithful to our Lord, don't we? Unpopularity and the hatred of Christians towards us is our lot. Because if you're with the Lord Jesus Christ as a disciple, the grey monster people will reject you, humiliate you, come against you, do all kinds of stuff, because they don't want Jesus himself around, who's has a long history all through the scripture for dealing severely with miscreants. Hasn't he? And at the end of time, come judgment day, a little over 1,000 years away, people falling in mostly into death to await judgment day at the moment, people going to hell at the moment, and there are others continuing in the kingdom of heaven now, and bodies giving out and continuing with Jesus now in heaven. All this is going on all the time, but a little over 1,000 years down the road, after the 1,000-year reign of the Lord Jesus Christ, then comes that day. Who's sitting on the throne at that point? Why do people take this view that he'll be on his judgment throne then, but right now he's on his licentious, debauched, don't give a fig about anything throne? He hasn't changed. He was there at the beginning and he's there at the end. Why has he suddenly changed in the middle? He didn't, is the answer. It's simply because wicked and evil people will not receive the truth of God. They won't. Shan't. It impinges on my life. It makes me feel bad. It's like these crazy people will not preach the truth of God at all. And you get, say, you know, in extreme cases, the ordination of abominations, sick, debauched perverts being ordained by churches in church ministry, nothing to do with God whatsoever, of course. Gilding feces, insulting God. What's he going to do to them? Well, nothing instantly, because they're not his people to start with. The question isn't really, why isn't he dealing with these people in church? Church isn't anything to do with God, and those people that are being in the ordination of abomination, they're not his people anyway. He only chastens you and me, who are his people. Notice the work is going on in his people, which is why you see the revolting Antichrist system religion doing horrors but getting away with it. Quite simply, they're not his people. His name's not in the book of life. And the scripture says, if you're without chastisement, you are bastards and not sons. In other words, you aren't family. You're not members of the family of God. But we cross the line, we catch it, don't we? Absolutely. But who is this puffy Jesus? Who is it on that throne who, dividing the sheep from the goats on the last day, and throwing the goats at his left hand into the lake of fire, eternal fire. Who is that person? Well, it's the Lord Jesus Christ. He hasn't changed one little bit. He's focused on his work in you and me. We have a right to become like him, because if we're like him, we will agree with him and we'll absolutely hate the loathsome, disgusting filth of the world. We don't bring it into our meetings and ordain it like wicked church people do. We exclude it out. If God has not been pleased to do a work in somebody, they ain't family. They're not Israel, God's people. And we don't bring in the Egyptians, Hivites, Perizzites, Moabites, Midian, or what have you, in the camp. But the interesting pictures you see all through Scripture, like, say, Gideon, time of the Judges. In Gideon did something that militarily would look utterly ridiculous. But simply he was shown to do it. And actually the battle's the Lord's, and he just did his little bit, which is nothing really. And Midian fled in panic, killing each other. Didn't they? Notice infestation of the promised land was a consequence of disobedience and waywardness, wasn't it? And if only these people had kept covenant. But at the end of time, people around us that we know, your friends, your family, your neighbors, your children, who are not God's people, the Lord saving out of the world a people for himself, the vast bulk of humanity will be thrown in the lake of fire. Before that, there's the shock at the beginning of the 1,000-year reign of the Lord Jesus Christ on the earth, which isn't that far away. We're going to see Satan soon in his world headquarters, I believe. He'll be revealed in the Vatican, Frankie's Frog House, with his Sodomy Central, you know. I believe he'll be revealed there, and then he'll have a short time on the earth playing God. And this will give us a polar thing, because the bulk of humanity will gather to him and we will have polar opposite positions. A tiny minority of God's people and the vast bulk of humanity in the other camp. But then Jesus comes to reign with a rod of iron. And this people are going to be made to obey by force. His people who have died along the way, those who are with him now in the kingdom of heaven right now, brethren we've known who've died in the past, and I can name some of course, will be there to rule with him with a rod of iron. The standard is going to be what? The law of God. And the wicked will be made to do righteousness. This is going to be Big Brother par excellence, isn't it? No one will be able to escape anything. Their every thought, word, intention and deed is known to God. And there's no hiding anything anywhere in that reign. And those who are sub-rulers, those who work with him, us, who if we are faithful, will be exacting God's way on those miscreants. So why are we in licentious debauchery now, or so many professing Christians that way? Why? Has Jesus changed? And if you have overruled God and his way amongst his people, you are a downright wicked child of the devil, aren't you? And it's about time you got your brain in gear and realized this is not a game. Puffy Jesus of church doesn't exist. You got a mental idol between your ears, not the real person. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Licentious debauchery, church puffery, is nothing to do with God. Nothing at all. You and I have the privilege of being changed into the image of Jesus Christ if we will go with him. And to be just like Jesus, family nature and everything. And if we have his nature, we too will hate sin, filth and wickedness, and we will be loyal. Look at that man for a last example. Phineas, He, in the record we see of a man taking, I think it was a Moabite woman, wasn't it? Took her into his tent before all Israel. In other words, he took pollution into the camp. He married an immigrant. He married an immigrant. Took him to his tent. And Phinehas went in there with a spear, javelin, and thrust them both through. No doubt they were having sex. He thrust them both through. And he was commended for his action. Righteousness is going to be the order of the day when Jesus comes for 1,000 years. There won't be any prancing pillocks of the Anglican religion or the Charismatics, Baptists, and all kind of other deviant, compromising, nominal Christians. It isn't going to be there. There's going to be precision of righteousness and truth and God's order in every single detail. Now, this isn't judgment phase right now. We don't go visiting that on the wicked right now. But in our camp, we live perfectly unto Him ourselves, and it begins in us. And we live that right now. Because, you know, we got a taste for that and a love for that. A bit later on, it's going to be, if we're loyal now and faithful now, then we will also get to reign with Him. And we too will be used in the process of subduing Satan's body, the world, the body of Satan, while Satan's himself is in the pit for 1,000 years. We'll be ruling his body with a rod of iron for 1,000 years, and they will be made to do righteousness. And there won't be any more satanic Quranics, horrid Hindus, benighted Buddhists, Sikhs, dolly worshipping Catholics, or black rock groveling Muslims. Will there? And we will have righteousness on God's term, God's way, on God's earth. I hope that rejoices your heart, because if it does, it's because His things are in you.